Well, good afternoon. I'll be talking about the development of a typeface from the handwritten Sinhala placards of Sri Lanka. Well, what got me to do this research was simply this. Okay, there you go. A placard. Plakaten is also a placard. It's the term, it's a Dutch term. Placard is an affixed notice. So why this is important is simply because it is the first printed document in Sri Lanka. So to take a closer look at the letter, the document itself is a fairly large one, which is in between an A4, A3 and an A2. The number of lines in the title, the original one, is 3, and the body copy itself is around 55 lines. And the letter form itself is a monolinear, and it's the same font that they have used for the title itself. So it's why I wanted to do this is simply to figure out how this letter was created. And why? Because this is more like Gutenberg and the first letter. So when Gutenberg started designing, I'm sure he didn't just get up in the morning and suddenly say, I want my letter to be a black letter. So the term black letter or a Gothic letter form or style comes in later on with people being able to discovering different letter forms that has evolved with time. So simply what I want to do for Sinhala typography is I want to classify it according to how it has developed. So as a starting point, this is my research on how this has developed. So for me, the search on the designer, we know his name. He's called Gabriel Skard. He's a Dutchman, also known as the Baas of the VOC Armory in Colombo. Baas is also the meaning, which is chief of the Armory of Colombo. So I don't have the face for this person, but I have the first letter. So why a Dutchman is a question, is I just want to give you a feedback on where I'm coming from. Okay, so now this is around the 17th century. As most of in the West, we have a lot of explorers coming towards this end of the world. So why they come is simply because of our spices, and of course they want to spread the word of God. So with this, we have, before they came in, we had the Portuguese in Sri Lanka. So they call it Taproben. So afterwards, the Dutch comes in. They call it Zeeland or Ceylon. The British comes after and they call it Ceylon. And finally, well, right now, for the time being, it's called Sri Lanka. So what happened here is when it comes, going back into the 17th century, so it was 1640 to 1796, we had the Dutch administration in Sri Lanka. So which is the VOC, so mainly known as the Dutch East Indian Company, which is not the the main government, but it's a group of company who came in. So VOC takes over the central and the local government of Ceylon, so we have the Dutch administration, and the Dutch needed to communicate to the natives. So to do this, they use proclamations, publications, orders to its people, and to do this, they used a placard. So in Sri Lanka, we had natives, different groups of people. So we have the Sinhalese who speak Sinhala. We have the Tamil who speak Tamil and the Moors who also speak Tamil. So right now, what happened is I needed to know what influenced this designer for me to call something, what do we call it? What do we call this letter form? So I needed to go back and look at the scripts of that era. So to start off, I first figured out what a placard was, and then these were notices in public places, Well, it was notices to the natives with written in Sinhala, Tamil, so that people will understand. Why they would understand is simply because this would be a notice that will be pasted on public building. So we have, with that we have the first placard. Now, to start off this research, what I did is I wanted to understand the manuscripts. So with the manuscripts, I go into the archives where we have the first printed document. And in the archives, we have all these documents cataloged under Jurians, who is also a Dutch, a lady who came into Sri Lanka to compile all the placards, which is all over, because they were crumpled up in different places. And thereafter, luckily for us, we have this document, which is in safe hands, most probably, I'll read this out for you. So it's on the 5th of April, 1737, a document in Sinhala characters was turned out by the press in the armory, a placard. The number of copies printed is unknown, but one of them escaped the destination, which was the usual fate of documents of this type. Has been found in the archives, catalogued, and carefully repaired, and afford an opportunity of studying Skard's craftsmanship. So I go into this and I find lot number one, reference number 2440. So this is actually the first set of documents, which is, so in this lot we have manuscripts from, we have manuscripts written and printed in Sinhala, Dutch, and Tamil. So I look at the Sinhala, there are 15 handwritten and 7 printed. Within the 7, we have the first. So my question again was, what influenced this person? So within the set of 15, I look at the placards, which are, like, some of them are mostly repaired, carefully repaired, but torn. Some, during the preparation process, it had got smudged. So I took around 8 placards, and I tried to take letters that were much more clearer. And now to do the comparison, what I did is I took the current alphabet, which has 60 letters, and I made sure I needed a system to analyze it. So what I did was, within the 60, I realized there were some letters that were not in use, which is usually the case. And it keep, because the letters and the forms keep developing. So as a base, I look at Professor J.B. Desanayake, who's a known professor on the subject, and he has divided 10 categories on how the letter starts and ends. So it's more like what I did is, I take the 60 letters, I group them according to the 10 starts and how the 10 ends. And each of it, all the letters that start with this shape ends up in one group. This shape goes on. So each one gets something of a graph like this. So ultimately, I'm supposed to get 20 letters. Yes, I did get 20 letters. Now, then I need to do the sampling. I randomly picked samples from the placards, the handwritten placards, and I got it together. And then obviously there were places where I had spaces, simply because some letters were not there. So ultimately the result was, I ended up with 15 root letters, two forms, which is R is, has the start and the end. So it's two letters are repeated, and we have another two, which we don't have evidence of its existence. And another letter, which we have only one in use throughout those placards. So out of this, I find two styles of writing. So there is calligraphy, which I call it calligraphy style A and calligraphy style B. Now calligraphy style A would have three, we had only three placards, and then B had 13, totally coming up to 15. So I picked two of each. So this is how it looked like. They vary in size, obviously, but I tried to now compare it. Now, the importance of this study is about how would you want to keep this letter form or understand the letter form. So I needed to justify the two styles to understand how the letter was constructed, because I could simply look at the form of the letter and compare it, but what I needed to do is, if to compare, I needed to know how it was written. This is how the letter would look in general. So it's, when you look at it very carefully, you see three strokes coming out. We can't understand how the stroke would come out. Simply how the movement. So what I did is I compared the letter. So there were two ways of doing it. One is step one, I illustrated the letter compared with how the letter is written today, which is like a basic form of doing it. And two would, I started studying the ink flows. So how it works is, now I know how the letter is written, so this box shows of how the letter is written in the current day. And now focusing on this area of the letter, so whereas this area looks like this. So I believe it would have been something like this. So overall the letter appears like this, but I'm not satisfied. Yes, so I go into the next stage. So this is just like a close-up of what I did. It's the same thing, so I'm going to just slide through quickly. Second was to understand the flow of ink. Now, why ink is simply because we, at this time, we were new to the tool, the ink and the paper and the pen. So whereas we were using a stylus and ola leaf and the charcoal. So we were new to the instrument. Obviously that letter also had to change. Now whereas the issues on ola leaf writing is not found in paper simply because it's a smoother surface. And also the letter itself is a monolinear. Whereas here when we bring in the pen, we have a thick and a thin contrast of the letter coming in. So what I did is I started categorizing it. I just took letters and I looked at the places where I find ink traps and ink blots. Now ink blot is something where I confirm saying a conscious stop of the stroke. The other, which is ink trap, there are two interpretations that I give, is a stroke placed adjacent to another stroke. I'll go in detail visually for you to understand. And the other is the overlapping of a continuous stroke which creates a knot. So I take the letter R and I identify where are the places where I have these blots, the places where it gets confused, especially when I'm understanding the letter because I wouldn't know how it's written. And the, point number one, step one, understanding was that the letter does not look right. So it's something like this. Now I know, observing this, the letter, there is a flow of letter. So, and then with this, I reconstruct very carefully and understand why the block is there. So we have this, the flow of the letter coming. And this is not the way we write the letter now. So with that, when the ink gets trapped. This is the continuous stroke which I'm referring to that creates a knot. So these two gets together and then we find this blot in between. So as a result, we have that particular ink blot. And then the other part of the letter is this area. So I take a close up of that. Is I look at it, I take it, and then there is another loop that is happening, another knot, and constructs the other part of the letter. So close up was there are two adjacent lines, so intersections, and then of course we have a trap. So obviously that is why there was a huge blot at that stage. So understanding all this, I was able to get to the, well of course there was another part to the letter, it goes on. And the third is this, whereas I'm talking about this space where close-up was here. So whereas we have an existing blot, and around that we have another circle going around. So ultimately what happened, this was what I initially thought, how it was, but whereas this is the close-up of how this letter would have been constructed. So with this I was able to confirm the two styles of this methodology, and thereafter I took the samples, I took the letters out, and I tried to redo this, and then reconstructing with speed. Now ultimately what happens is we have the letter, I write it in the same way because I now know the flow of how the pen was moved, and with speed the lines keep getting shorter, some lines disappear, and as a result we have the same R in several ways. So here in a place like this we would see the top part, here we would miss out on it, and so on. I wouldn't have been able to do it, I understand how the letter was constructed unless I actually saw this, redid it myself. So this research is more into how to analyze a script of something that you're not very, you know it, but then you cross-examine it. So it's ultimately a methodology that I'm helping out y'all with, so that y'all could test it out on scripts in certain places. So ultimately, I go into the letter, and I see why it's so, and within the two styles, calligraphic style A and calligraphic style B, I've realized a lot of features are found in calligraphic style B. So with that, I confirmed that in certain places, why this, whereas present day appearance is this, but why it is like, takes this type of appearance in the first letter, simply because of the way it was written. So that is my research on how I developed and proposed several ideas on the first typeface. Thank you.